My friends, we do have somebody on the line. Let's not keep him on the line. We've got George Anthony, for the singer of Battalion of Saints, the band you just heard. Let's bring him on now. Hey, George, can you hear us okay, man?
Sure can.
Great.
Are you calling from San Diego?
No, I'm calling. I live in Alameda, which is up in the Bay Area. I live on a sailboat.
Oh, do you really?
Oh, lucky you.
Yeah, yeah. I moved from San Diego a while ago, but I always go back because my kids are there, and that's where I'm from.
Yeah, I'm sitting here with Sister Tracy. She's the co-host of the show.
Uh-huh.
Hey, George. What's it like living on a sailboat, first of all, I have to ask?
Really great.
Man, it sounds great.
Yeah, I mean, and the rent's cheap for the Bay Area, and I love it. It's something that I never thought I would ever do in my life, but it's probably the most coolest and comfortable place I've ever lived.
I was getting ready to ask, is that something you aspired to do, or...?
What?
I was getting ready to ask, is that something you aspired to do or something that
nothing like that ever. It was just one of those things that popped up, and my girlfriend happened to have a sailboat, and she's like, you're here. And I'm like, okay. And so I've been living here for the last 3 years.
Wow,
and,
awesome.
And I go back and forth from San Diego and see my kids and my family and stuff. But I love it. And it would probably be really hard for me to go back to, like, living in an apartment if I ever do, or a house or whatever, but because I like it so much.
You get to see any cool things like sharks and whales at night or during the day?
Well, there's a lot of seals, and it's really weird. You'll see some really big stingrays come through. And it's kind of weird because they'll eat the moss on the side of the dock.
Ah.
And you're just like, what the hell is that?
Yeah. Are you a seafood fan, man?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, I'm a chef. Like, the whole time when the Battalion of Saints was going on and starting, I had gone to chef school, and I was being a chef during the recording Fighting Boys and Second Coming. And then when we, like, broke up the first time when Chris left and all, I was living in D.C., being a chef there, and got voted best new chef in Washington, D.C. in 87. And I had, like, I was doing a lot of activities that are probably not very healthy and you don't really talk about on the radio.
Yeah, I understand those things.
Yeah, but I still managed to do get a good job. So I was in Washingtonian magazine and all that kind of stuff.
It's interesting because I actually met you in person back, I think it was the 1985 tour, and you played in Champaign, Urbana, Illinois.
Yeah, yeah.
And at the time, a girlfriend I was dating was the promoter of the show, and we picked you guys up, or we didn't pick you up, we met you, I think you had a van, but we had to, like, give you guys a ride to the clinic, if you know what I mean.
Oh, yeah, it wasn't me.
And I don't mean the methadone clinic.
nothing like that. It was actually, they had I never went to one of those things. I thought that was a waste of time. You're going to quit, you quit. But I know somebody who had to get some shots for something that they picked up on the road.
That's what I'm talking about, yeah. Captain Scarlet and you and Chris and whoever else.
Well, I'm knocking on my head. I never got any of those wonderful social diseases at the time. Or even later, as a matter of fact. I was like the only one that was pretty lucky.
Well, it's just funny because I was going through my cassette tape collection the other night and found that we actually recorded that show, and I actually have a cassette of that performance, man.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Not sure.
I'd love to hear that because we had gotten rid of James Cooper because he had started the tour, but then he became really difficult and stuff, so we kind of gave him the boot when we were going through D.C., and Captain Scarlet, who was our tour manager at the time, started playing bass for us.
That's right.
Yeah, and we had written like three songs, and which is really funny because I came across the tapes of only two of the songs. I don't know what happened to the third song. I can't find it. But we just re-recorded them.
Oh, wow.
Tino from the Cryptic, which is now who plays drums for us now, and Pine Hill Records.
Okay.
So we're going to be releasing a discography of everything.
Nice.
Yeah, because we actually was really weird. So we had got all the tapes and we started baking them, and because you have to bake when they're really old tapes like that, you have to bake them or dehydrate and get all the moisture out of them. And we were like listening to them, and all of a sudden I go, "Well, what's this song? this song's never been recorded. What?"
Totally.
And it was Angelic Upstarts, "I Ain't Never Had Nothing" song we had recorded.
Interesting.
But we never did anything with it. It was on the original tape. And so I went, last time I was in San Diego, was like about 2 months ago. I did the lead vocals on it. I had Sean from Lower Class Brats come in and do some backups. And so we finished the song. And it sounds friggin' great. And so we were like pretty excited about it. And then we got those other songs that are going to be on the new album as well. And trying to get some other recordings that were never released with the other guys and stuff like that. So it's like all the stuff that was like all those people like Mystic and people like that who never did anything for us anyways, we're releasing those songs. So everything we've ever done is going to be out on this.
Really cool. I can't wait to get a copy of that bad boy.
Yeah, it's I'm pretty excited about it.
That's
and,
awesome.
Then I'm going to finish up. We have a 16-song album that we're releasing after that. So I got to finish going down and finishing up. And Greg Heston was going to do leads on that. And it was just me and Tino Velpa played all the instruments. And then Greg is going to do the leads. I got to go down to the studio, it sounds like, and just finish it up and then go down to San Diego and finish mixing it.
Nice.
So, yeah. So we're pretty excited about that. So we have, like, two big releases coming up this summer, and one of them is probably be more like fall.
But two of them this year, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. It's like some original artwork. We got, the original one, I can't remember the guy's name, sorry. He's going to be... the discography is going to be like a picture of all the. He's going to hand draw all the records, and all the big pile and stuff like that. And
oh, that's cool.
It's pretty exciting about all the stuff that's going on.
Yeah.
With it, and then you do all the lyric sheet for it and all nine yards. So.
Well, speaking of like past members and the history of the band and all of that, with so many of your original members being dead, I have to ask you: do you feel lucky, or do you just feel like it's like borrowed time?
Oh, I feel lucky.
Do you?
Oh yeah, because like the whole time when all this was going on, especially in the early '80s, everybody's like, "Oh, George, you're the first to go." Because like
surprise,
I was a definite king of. I'm going to party till there's just no partying at all that can be done.
So how do you do it these days? Are you sober these days for the most part or all the way?
I drink a little bit.
Yeah.
I have fun. I don't do anything really into an excess. I don't drink for a lot at all. I barely drink, but when I go out to dinner, I enjoy a glass of wine or if I go to a show, I enjoy a couple of drinks and that's pretty much it.
That's cool. You just keep it under control.
Oh yeah. Yeah, it's like I get it that some people just cannot just have a couple of drinks.
Yeah, like me, I can't, man. You know,
and it's to me that's okay. Obviously, if you have to get into the NA and all that stuff, that's their thing. But I don't really have to because I controlled it.
Yeah. Well, that's cool. You recently played a tour, and unfortunately, we were doing the radio show that same night. But you played in Medford, Oregon, just down the road from us, and we had to miss the damn show, man.
Yeah, it was in that dude's basement.
Yeah, the Pirate Punks.
Yeah.
How was that show?
That was a lot of fun.
Was it a good show?
Yeah, really good. And yeah, we did that for.
Yeah, I was so bummed out because last time I saw you was '85. I'm like, wow, I really wanted to see you guys. So the next time around, I'm there, man. Wherever there is.
We're gonna be touring a lot once these albums come out. It's gonna be where we got some new musicians. One from LA. Hold on, let me get all their names right here because I'm pretty bad at remembering everything.
Yeah, I hear you.
Yeah.
That's respectful of you.
I got Mike is from like, Mike Cantrell, who's going to be playing guitar, and bass is Dylan DiCarlo. And Mike's from Riverside, and Dylan's from Flagstaff, Arizona.
Right on.
And our drummer is, and writer, my co-writer on the new album is Chino Velpa. He's also the president of Pine Hill Records, who we're going to be doing the European tour coming up in end of July and beginning of August. We're playing like Rebellion and Leeds and some other festivals, so we're pretty excited about it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Is there anything you wish you would have done more of or less of back in the early days of Battalion of Saints? Like anything you would have done differently, or you know, more or less, anything you would have changed?
Probably. I should have kept going. But at the time when we broke up, it was kind of like one of those things where it's like, we had just finished off 9 months of touring, and everybody was pretty tired. And so we kind of just like, I moved to DC for like 2 years. Chris had moved to New York and then later died. And
yeah.
Then, Captain Scarlet moved back to England, and Jerry moved back to Miami, and or in New York. He moved to New York. So it was kind of like, I could have kept going, but I was just kind of like, eh. You know, I just kind of got burnt out. And at the time too, all the bands that were at that time were going a bit wonky as well. So it was kind of a good time to
call it a day.
Stop. Yeah, yeah. But then I got tired of not doing anything, and got back together. And that's when Cherry Bones was with UK Subs, came by, and we went in the studio and recorded the Hell's Around the Next Corner single. And we did that one, those two songs, and through with you, like an afternoon. And then they left. I went and wrote the song, came back and recorded the single, and then we put it out on Tang.
Ah, so then you were, the bug had bitten you once again.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. It's been, you know, I've been trying to keep going, but you know how it is. There's great musicians, and there's that have been played in my band that had to either stop because they had kids, and like Mario had stopped and had his daughter and couldn't tour anymore at the time, and then he went off, and then which I was, thought that was so cool. And he does Earthless. He's always been doing Earthless for forever, and Hot Snakes,
yeah,
and stuff, you know. And he's a great guy, and I always enjoy seeing him and stuff. But you know, most of the guys, like, you know, the guys from Total Chaos are always touring. And then there's like just a lot of guys that have gone and done everything. So.
Yeah. One of your fans and one of our listeners, he sent an email over earlier and wanted us to ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
Since it's Easter and you're on the show, it's the Easter show. They want to know what your views of are on Easter or religion, and what your day consisted of on Easter today.
Well, going and doing a long walk around the Air Force base, eating a sandwich, and not doing much of anything.
It sounds like our day.
I'm not really a big religious person anymore, or even, at all. I just think that when it comes to religion, it just depends on what you think and what you believe in and stuff. And a lot of it, I just think, is a whole lot of hooey. And so, but, you know, that's my thing. And I believe that the church should be taxed. I believe that they should be, you know, have a free charge and then be in charge of, like, politics and stuff. So that's my thing. I just think that people that are looking for some sort of, like, savior or make themselves feel good about living and all that stuff, it's nothing but themselves that'll make themselves happy.
Yeah.
It's not a God, and it's not all that. So that's what my thinking of it is. And so, you know. People don't think they think I'm like some atheist and stuff. Like, I'm not really an atheist, but I'm not really, you know, pro-religion, because I think it's so jacked up, and what the horrible things that they've done to American Indians and stuff like that. Because, you know, I'm an Indian, and so I was been watching these shows, and I get so like, really?
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, how can religion is supposed to be about loving and all this other stuff just kill so many people?
Well, and divide so many people. It seems to be dividing more than it does bringing people together as of late. So, yeah, I get your point.
Yeah, it's just, it's not, that's not what it was there for. If you just go
Yes. Pretty much, yeah.
You know, and then, and if you go by that, then you can live a healthy, comfortable life. If you don't really need a lot of money. You don't really need a lot of things. You know, that's how I look at it. And to live in a big old house, yeah, that's cool, but I've done that, and it's not that big of a deal. It ends up owning you.
Yeah, it does.
And having all this, like, personal stuff, it's like, as long as I can have a good stereo, a good woman, a good TV, and, like, good time, and have, be able to have good times and share it with somebody, okay, I'm happy. And my kids are healthy and smart, and they're not in trouble. Everything's good.
Now, what more can you ask for, man, really, you know?
Exactly.
And especially exactly. Being in the business that you're in, you know, show business, whether it's Hollywood or whether it's rock and roll, there's so many people that have fallen kind of casualty to fame and to money.
Oh, yeah.
You
and,
know?
Are they really, and the people that have lots of money, are they really, truly happy? No.
Yeah.
Everybody, they think that everybody's out to get them. And it's like, why would you care? I mean, it's like people say all kinds of, like, things about me and stuff, and I just kind of like go, well, you know, you really don't know me then. If you're gonna say like bad stuff, that's fine. I can be a complete jerk, yes, but do I really, am I like saying like, you know, horrible racist things to somebody or something like that? No,
right?
Because, you know, it's just, why, you know, we're all supposed to be like the human race is supposed to treat each other nicely, but it's never gonna happen.
Yeah.
Because everybody has to find somebody to hate. You know, and it's kind of a drag.
Well, and so. you've sure touched on, you know, a lot of political stuff and things like that over the years, and your music kind of known for that. But do you still, do you find yourself when you're writing new material? I mean, God knows you have a lot to choose from right now. Do you still find yourself, you know, writing that sort of music?
I can't help it.
Yeah.
I can't help it. It's like politics or people just cannot tell the truth to save their lives.
Yeah.
And things like that, you're just like, well, yeah, I could think about, you know, something else, but it's like, this is what really bugs me. And so
yeah,
I'm still in the same vibe of that. You know, I remember one time this guy did an interview or review of something. I think it was one of our records. And he goes, how could George Anthony be mad? Is he yelling at people to get off his grass or something? And I'm like, one, I don't have grass. Right. You know, I don't have a lawn. Everything still gets me angry, but I'm not going to like go out and like, you know, burn down some house or do stupid crap like that, because it's, what's that going to do?
Yeah.
Put me in jail? No, I don't want to go to jail. You know, I'm not going to go to jail. I haven't been in jail, and I keep it that way for a reason.
Got a few minutes left, George. I wanted to ask you this. One time I was told, I don't know if it's true, but you guys did a cover of Ace of Spades back in the day in 82, which we're going to play actually after the interview. Yeah. I was told that Lemmy from Motorhead actually was quoted as saying that was his very favorite cover of Ace of Spades that he'd ever heard.
Yes. Yeah. Well, what happened was we started doing it, and it was really funny because we'd start playing the song and we'd get like, we started doing these bigger shows at like Olympic and stuff. We started playing them, and like, there'd be like, you know, 8,000 people there, and there'd be like, you know, 16,000 fingers flipping us off or doing it. And but we didn't care because it was a great song.
Yeah.
It was before everybody was, oh, my hits are too. You know what I mean? It was way before all that stuff. And I got the number from Charlie Harper, Lemmy's number. I still even have it in my phone book. And so I asked him, I go, can I have his number? And he goes, yeah, sure. And so he gave it to him. I called him up, and he's like, well, we'd like to do a cover of Ace of Spades. And he goes, yeah, go ahead, baby. And so we send him the record, and Gil from Girl School answers the phone, and I go, hey, let me know. Now he's in the studio, but I'm going to go, because there's the most George Anthony Battalion Saints. Oh, Battalion Saints, you did Motorhead. I hate the Space better than Motorhead. And Lemmy loved it.
Nice.
Best thing he's ever heard. And he's like, he goes, yeah, you keep it going. And we're like, oh, yeah.
That's so cool, man.
Yeah.
That's really cool. You know, George, we're running out of time, man. I wanted to say thanks a million for taking the time on such short notice to come on the show, man.
Yeah, no problem.
Definitely like to have you back on sometime and like to play some more of your new stuff when it gets released. You know, definitely. Again, thanks for taking time on Easter to join us, dude.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks so much, George.
Have a nice Easter on April Fool's.
Hey, right? What a perfect day for us all to talk.
Right? So, happy April Fool's. Ah, my uncle.
Punk rock. All right, brother. Well, thanks so much, dude, and we'll talk to you down the road.
Thanks, George.
All right, take care.
All right, take care, man.